دع الأيام تفعل ما تشاء وطب نفسا إذا حكم القضاء ولا تجزع لحادثة الليالي فما لحوادث الدنيا بقاء وكن رجلا على
الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome to this night's program. Alhamdulillah, we have it every Friday night. Inshallah, up close and in front of Sheikh Yasir Qadhi, hitting him with some serious personal questions. I hope you guys are ready, because today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to speak about Sheikh Yasir's personal life, his upbringing, the family he came from, his experiences, and how he became who he is today. Sheikh Yasir, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair for having me on. It's a bit of an awkward thing to be put on the hot seat, but inshallah. Also, from the beginning, it's not a false sense of modesty, but I want to be careful that you're saying he became who he is today and whatnot. Subhanallah, we are all worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are all equally in this together. We, all of us, are servants of Allah Azza wa Jalla. There's no superiority except with taqwa, and that real taqwa is of course hidden in the heart. Only Allah Azza wa Jalla knows that. Allah says in the Quran, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِوَنِ التَّقَى. Do not consider yourselves or others to be pious. Only Allah Azza wa Jalla knows who has actual taqwa, and we hope to be amongst the muttaqeen, inshaAllah.
May Allah bless you, Shaykh, and Allah ibadah feek. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase you in humbleness and increase the ummah from your likes and the likes of the scholars and tullab al-ilm that continue to give back to this ummah. Wallahi, the time that we live in today, we are in such dire need of ulama. We are in such dire need of ulama, people who understand the deen, so they can tell us what to do in these types of situations that arise in the ummah. But today, inshallah, we're not going to talk about the pandemic that we're living through right now. We're actually going to change it up. Today we want to do something that's way past due. Sheikh Yasir never really introduced himself and his life and his past experiences to the community. So today, inshallah, we wanted to take advantage of this night and this Q&A session to ask the Sheikh about his family, his upbringing, and his life experiences. Sheikh, the first question for you today, inshallah, is can you tell us a little bit about your family background? I know your family were very active in the Islamic da'wah field, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, and obviously this is tabi'i, this is natural, like in every family, mashallah, that is active in the da'wah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses them with offspring that continue to give back to the community, continue to be active. So how was your family active? What were they doing? And how were you inspired by that?
So my father came to America in 1962 as a graduate student to do a master's in biology and pathology from the University of Houston. And he came as a single person at the time. And he was, alhamdulillah, of the first batch of immigrant Muslims to come here. So he was here at a very critical time in America. And so he, alhamdulillah, founded the very first masjid in Houston, Texas. He actually is the founder of the MSA, the Muslim Students Association in Texas. And his name is still there to this day, of the founding document of the first MSA. And I didn't even know this as I was going through the MSA. I had no clue. You know, you grow up and you have no clue what your parents have done, obviously, and what their past is. All of this I found out later on. But he founded the MSA that I was very active with at the University of Houston. I had no clue, completely, you know, Qadr Allah.
So, Sheikh, you had no idea?
I had absolutely no idea that my father founded the very MSA that shaped me, you know, in the 90s. He founded it back in the 60s. I had no idea, absolutely. No. And it was only later on, after coming back from Medina, that I actually found out. Like, he never, you know, he's a quiet man. He doesn't talk about these things. And it's just, you know, you uncover it bit by bit. His name is on the founding document of what is now the largest network of masajid in all of North America, the Islamic Society of Greater Houston, ISGH. It has over 25 masajid in all of Houston. It is the largest in all of North America. And alhamdulillah, my father founded the first, which is, of course, then he's now, you know, he was given an honorary prize last year by the ISGH. And he was very active with the Jamaat-e-Islami movement, which is now ICNA. He's also one of the founders of ICNA in that regard. So I grew up in a very religious household. I did not know at the time, again, this is something I'm finding out later on, but my great-grandfather was actually a sheikh and an alim, and he had studied in India, and he had gone to a village to be the sheikh and the mufti of the village, and that's why I have the name Qadi, actually. It comes from my great-grandfather that he was called Qadi by the people of that village. The village is called Jabalpur. And he founded a madrasa. I had no idea. All of this is coming later on. No clue. I finished Medina, and I come back to Yale, and I began digging into my family history. And I was shocked to discover my great-grandfather was actually a sheikh and a mufti and a qadi, and that's where we got the name. I had no clue that he's actually studied Islam, memorized the Quran. And subhanAllah, these things are all, you know, just this history moves on, and we don't know it's there. But alhamdulillah, so I was very blessed to be born in to parents that are very religious and very interested in da'wah. And alhamdulillah, it shaped me subconsciously. The choice to go to Medina was my own, but no doubt the upbringing that I had, the values were absorbed in by that. And I thank Allah Azza wa Jal for having blessed me with such parents.
Alhamdulillah. So Sheikh, do you think this was the reason you decided to pursue Islamic knowledge?
There's no doubt that that played a very pivotal role. The real catalyst for me, I mean, the upbringing I had was, I would say, just moderately religious. So alhamdulillah, as long as I can remember praying five times a day, my father encouraged and, you know, kind of sort of pushed me, which is fine as a teenager, to memorize the Quran. I didn't want to memorize the Quran. You know, he's like, I remember having a tantrum with him at 12, 13 years old. I don't want to memorize the Quran, you know, and he's like, you know, it's like it's standard stuff, you know, at the time. And I was very angry that I was forced to sit instead of playing outside with my friends, you know, I was forced to sit after school, and the Maulvi Sahab or the Sheikh would come and memorize the Quran with me. But of course, all that's, you know, hindsight. So when I got to University of Houston, the main catalyst for me was discovering that I genuinely liked being religious. Like, you know, when you're in university, you're free, right? You don't have the pressures of your parents on you. Mm. And if you want to, you can go down a path and nobody knows about it. And Allah protected me that, subhanAllah, I actually found that I wanted to be religious and I liked religiosity. And in 1991, one of my main teachers who really inspired me immensely, and he's, alhamdulillah, still alive in America, but he's kind of low-key now. He was traveling through Houston and he gave a class, and I was 17 years old at the time. Not yet 17, I think 17. And I attended a class on the sciences of hadith. Sciences of hadith. And this teacher was a convert, a Caucasian convert. And it was mesmerizing to me to see somebody who was not born into the faith quoting a hadith from the top of his head and telling me about the isnads and telling me about my religion in a way that I had memorized the Quran and I didn't know. And he spoke Arabic and I didn't speak Arabic. I had memorized the Quran. I'm from an Indian Pakistani background. I couldn't understand a word, right? I don't know what it's saying. I just memorize it the way that we memorize it, you know? And to meet somebody like this, I was completely mesmerized. And it introduced me to a whole group of other people who had studied knowledge. I was very active with, back in the day, if you know this, the Quran and Sunnah Society. This is early 90s, and they're a group that is very much trying to follow the Salaf, very much into what is the evidence and where do you get this. And it was just mesmerizing for me to meet this group of people that seemed to know the classical texts and seemed to know whether hadith is in Sunan al-Nisa'i or Musnad Imam Ahmad. You know, these are things you vaguely hear about growing up. But to meet somebody who's actually read these books and can quote them to you, it just blew me away. Mm. And that led me down academic Islam. My family made me, alhamdulillah, by the blessings of Allah, religious, but not into advanced studies. That wasn't, you know, my father is not a sheikh in the traditional sense. He's somebody who loves Islam and was always connected with Islamic activism, just wanting to be a good Muslim. But he wasn't connected with ulama per se. But when I got to university, it was there that I met a group of people who really blew me away with their mastery of the texts. And of course, I went through a phase of basically, you know, ultra hardcore, which is, you know, I tell my, you know, my friends of the era that, you know, alhamdulillah, being a little bit more overzealous in religion is better than being crazy in other things of the dunya, you know, because people go through phases. And when I was a teenager, I went through a phase of like hardcore Islam, you know, like this is haram, this is kufr, this is bid'ah, this is very, everything is black and white to you back then, you know, and if you know what strand I'm talking about, you understand what I'm trying to say here.
So Sheikh, you were actually like that for a bit?
I was like that, 17, 18, 19, I was like that, that, you know, when I got to Medina, believe it or not, actually even the first year of Medina began to open my horizons and I began to mature up. See, a very little bit of knowledge is a very dangerous thing. Mm. Just a little bit of knowledge is the most dangerous, because when you're a jahil, you know you're a jahil, right? When you gain just a little bit, you feel very arrogant, very like haughty. I know what my teacher said is haram and halal. You know, your teacher is one opinion. Good, excellent. There's other opinions out there as well. But I went through that phase. I did my degree in engineering, graduated 1995 with my degree in chemical engineering. And alhamdulillah, I got a job offer from Dow Chemical. At the time, I had interned at Dow Chemical in their plant in Freeport. And I had spent a summer there, three full months there. I had written a 3,000 line computer program in a language that most of you never heard of. It's called Fortran 77. It's all gone by now. Yeah. That I had simulated polymer reactions in a laboratory. So if you put in specific polymers, a type of plastic, what would be the projected output? So I wrote a very, you know, elaborate program. My boss was very impressed, wrote me recommendation, like hire this kid as soon as he graduates, you know. And alhamdulillah, I had a job offer, you know, from Dow Chemical, the only one of my class to have a job offer without even graduating, sorry, before graduating, I should say, you know, before graduating. In 1994, I went to Medina to apply to Medina as an Umrah student, as an Umrah visa. So I wanted to, you know, The name University of Medina was already floating in those circles. Now, I know it's difficult for people to understand this, but back in the early 90s, nobody had heard of the University of Medina. It was unknown in the national American scene. I had heard of it because one of my teachers had studied 1 year, just 1 year at the University of Medina, and then come back. So he hadn't even graduated. It was an unknown, really, university at the time. And they didn't have American students. When I got accepted, they had a grand total of 9 students. 9. Nowadays, they have 250.
From America?
From America.
Okay.
9 students from America. That's all that they had. And I applied in 1994. I went for Umrah visa, and I submitted my application to get accepted to Medina. 1995, I graduated, and I had the Dow Chemical offer, and I had the University of Medina offer on my table. I had a very, very difficult choice to make. And it was a difficult choice for me because I understood the repercussions of, no, I didn't fully understand, but I thought I understood that this is a radical career shift for me. So I made my choice, as you all know the choice I made, and I never looked back, alhamdulillah. One thing led to another, and alhamdulillah, here I am.
So Sheikh, like, did you decide to study, to pursue Islamic studies while you were in engineering school or right when you graduated?
So I was flirting with the idea of full-time Islamic education since I was a sophomore. And just the yearning became stronger and stronger that I don't want to spend the rest of my life behind the desk solving nth degree quadratic equations, the way I phrase it. I don't want to spend the rest of my life becoming another statistic of another upper middle class Muslim American. And I really felt an emptiness spiritually, like I really felt. And I remember one day, it's just seared in my memory. I had a habit in university of sleeping on the floor, actually, believe it or not. I wouldn't sleep on my bed. And I had a blanket on the floor.
Like Zuhd?
I wish it was Zuhd. It's just, I liked it. It was easier for the back. I didn't like the soft cushions. Obviously, okay, when you get married, then that goes out the window. You have to. I mean, no, my entire years at university, I would sleep on the floor.
It's not part of that, like the extreme phase, right?
No,
like,
no.
Like you want it to be a Junaid or somebody.
No, okay. Nothing like that. Okay. No. I was always a big lover of ice cream and of good food, so that's never changed. Alhamdulillah. So I remember one day just looking at a pile of books, and because I was sleeping on the floor, so the pile was relatively high. And it was, you know, introduction to organic chemistry, you know, you have calculus 3, you have all of this, and it was just like this, like no exaggeration, like as high as this table. Kids don't want university, you got these big books and everything. And I remember thinking to myself, like, and alhamdulillah, this is not bragging or boasting, I've always been a straight A student. I was a valedictorian of my high school, and I've always had, you know, magna cum laude in engineering. I mean, alhamdulillah, even my Medina, everybody knows this, it's not, alhamdulillah, Allah bless me with that. So I was looking at all these books, and I'm like, subhanAllah, I really felt like I know all of this stuff, and I don't know my religion. Like, I felt an emptiness, like, I've mastered all of this and I don't understand the Quran, because at this stage I still didn't know Arabic, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm coming from a Indian Pakistani background, obviously, you know, Urdu is the language I speak at home. I didn't know Arabic at the time.
You never studied Arabic, Sheikh, before that?
No, I didn't study Arabic. I began studying Arabic actually on my own, 17 years old. Believe it or not, I'd never advise anybody to do this. It's really not, but there was no alternative. The only source I had was Sahih al-Bukhari, 9 volumes.
Allahu Akbar.
And so I began going through Sahih al-Bukhari with the Arabic and English. And you don't study Arabic that way. You just don't do that, you know.
But, did you have cassettes, you know, back then, Sheikh?
We did. I'm not that old. Of course we had cassettes back then, yes.
I'm not saying, like, I thought it was...
We had cassettes. You know, there weren't that many books in English back in 92, 93. Really, you have to understand it was a different time frame, very different time frame. The quantity of books that have come out is so much more. Back then, you know, the halal and haram of Islam of Qardawi was a big deal. And, you know, fiqh sunnah was still not translated. You know, that became a big deal in the mid-90s. So it's a very different era at the time frame. And I really just felt an emptiness. So it was something I was thinking about and more interested in. And I applied in 1994, December, I remember, because that was the winter break. And I applied in 94 December, and I still was uncertain, am I going to go, am I not going to go, am I going to get accepted? And it was only when I have the acceptance letter and I have to make that choice, you know? I mean, even in the summertime, and I had both of these, there was a time frame I'm thinking, because let's be honest here, you know, going to Medina at that time frame meant giving up careers and education, I mean, you know, income and delaying marriage, everything. Like, it was a very big thing, and it was not a decision that I made casually, and alhamdulillah, I did not look back after that decision was made. Alhamdulillah, whatever came with it, and I've never looked back since then.
So, Sheikh, was it purely your decision, or like were your parents 100% with it?
No, it was my decision at the time. And again, I understand. I have nothing but respect. At the time, let's just say my parents didn't understand what I was doing, but they gave me that freedom. And I respected them for that. They were not enthused, but they didn't stop me. And I understand, because in the end of the day, they financed my education. I just finished a degree. They really thought it was a phase or a fad I'm going through. And I do understand, because a lot of people did go through a phase and fad and then just fizzled out. I mean, Medina in particular was well known for dropouts. We had 80-90% dropout rate when I was there. You know, most of the people just came and just fizzled out and went back, you know. So it wasn't easy.
It's just the experience, Sheikh?
Everything. Just the experience, the difficulties, the classes, the language, finances, the culture, a bit of a racism as well, lots of things. I mean, just a whole bunch of factors are there that makes life very difficult. And obviously my parents didn't know any of that. They were just like, you know, you have a degree in engineering, you know, we financed, we helped you. I mean, alhamdulillah, they supported my decision and they respected my decision, but definitely the idea, I kind of sort of had to push it a little bit on them, and alhamdulillah, they let me go, alhamdulillah.
So that leads me into the next question, inshallah. So now, being the prized student, yani you were, mashallah, valedictorian in high school, and then you graduated, you were a straight A student in college, so you were obviously someone who appreciated good education and quality education. So you go, you leave the universities of Houston, Texas, and go to Medina to a startup university in the middle of a desert, right? And I'm sure, like, you know, Arabs, especially in that part of the world, don't really know too much about education, or didn't know at that time at least. Now, it started up, The university was there. I'm sure things weren't the way you were accustomed to them in the States, right? So can you tell us a little bit about that shock that you had when you went there and the daily routine you had as a student of knowledge when you first went?
Oh my God, you are bringing up a lot of memories. These types of talks that you're asking me these questions, I typically only answer to students that are going to go to Medina because their version of that world is very romanticized in the reality. Mm. And I don't like to shatter that bubble amongst the innocent people out there. Those that are going to Medina, and alhamdulillah, I keep in touch with most of the American students, there are a lot of them that end up going, they know my very, very frank talk to them. I don't want to be that frank. Let me just say that Medina is not your standard American university. It's a very different ambiance, very different, especially when I went. I went in 1995. Things have even changed since then. The buildings I was living in were actually constructed in the early 70s. And it was the same, like, very run down, and, you know, it was very difficult for me even to physically be in those areas. The massive dorms, you know, 7-8 people per room crammed together, one bathroom at the end of the hall. I mean, it was just a very different system. And then the culture as well, it was a huge, huge culture shock for me to come from an American university. And then come to the University of Medina. So many things, I mean, for example, when I got accepted, things have changed, by the way, very radically. University of Medina was around 5,000, 6,000 students, 90% of whom were foreign, or 85% were foreign. Only 10% were Saudi. And so you had students from all 200 nationalities, and just the multicultural environment, you know? To meet people who had never seen modern technology, we were with them, right? To meet people that had never, some of the people I were with from certain countries, no need to mention, they didn't even have three meals a day where they're coming from, you know? And so for them to get three meals a day was actually a perk and a blessing that, you know, they so imagine you are mixing with people of all of these diverse backgrounds, most of whom have never studied formally at all. The way that, you know, we're supposed to be studying. So imagine that environment. And then obviously, to put this gently, let's just say the people in charge and the professors and teachers themselves, let's just say gently, are of a different mindset and culture than what I'm accustomed to here in America, right? Mm. So it was a huge, huge culture shock, educational shock. And I went through the Arabic program. It's a 2-year program. I did that in 1 year. 1995 to 1996, I got my diploma in Arabic. It was called the Shu'bah, Shu'bah Ta'imnugh al-Arabiyyah. That was an eye-opener because everybody was non-Saudi. There are no Saudis studying Arabic there, you know. And that was very much like middle school in the whole ruckus environment and the, you know, the everything. Just, it was like middle school environment. People are just having fun, doing this and that. And I'm like, I didn't come here for this. I came here for knowledge, man. I didn't come for this. So anyway, zoom through that. And then came time to apply to the university, or not apply, but to choose the college. Back then, there were 5 colleges. There was the College of Quran and Quranic Sciences. There was the College of Hadith and Hadith Sciences. There was the College of Sharia and Fiqh, basically. There was the College of Arabic Language, Advanced Arabic Language. And then there was the College of Da'wah, or Preaching. And amongst these colleges, it was the reputation that Quran and Hadith were like the hardcore ones, right? Mm. And Sharia was for the generic serious student, and Arabic was for just people that are in, because the College of Arabic, you're studying Arabic literature. Most non-Saudis didn't come to Medina to study advanced Arabic literature. There was one or two foreigners, but it was mainly a Saudi college for them to get onto master's, PhD in advanced Arabic. And Da'wah, at the time, I'm just saying, the reputation was that's the easiest one. So I was between Quran and Hadith because I wanted like the hardcore, you know, that was me. I wanted the real deal. It was the smallest back then. The smallest colleges were Quran and Hadith. And I looked at the curriculums, and Quran was specializing in the 10 qira'at and memorizing the various ways to recite the Quran. And I realized if I wanted to do this, I could do this outside the college. I didn't want to spend 4 years just memorizing the various ways to do it. And alhamdulillah, I've done, you know, 4 or 5 of the qira'at on my own. So I've done that on the side. Mm-hmm. So I decided to go to College of Hadith. And I always had a love of hadith ever since my first teacher back in 1992 taught an intensive in English at the University of Houston. I remember still from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. I still have the notes, by the way, Allah somewhere Allah. In my thing, you know. So you I always said, them. I still have the notes. Allah I still have those notes. Every single course I've ever taken in my life, I still have the notes for. I never throw my notes away. I have all of the notes. I have files and files of notes that I've from the Islamic stuff, obviously, not the chemical engineering. That's even though I still have some of those. But
you didn't trash that, right?
I did not trash those. I never trashed my own notes. I keep them. And so I chose the College of Hadith, and I don't regret that choice at all. It's a very specialized college. It's a college that is very small. There was like only, you know, one batch. Like the College of Sharia had eight classrooms. And when I got accepted to Hadith, I think it was one at the time, and that split into two small classrooms. Mm-hmm. So it was 1/8 the size of the College of Sharia. The College of Da'wah had like 10 classrooms. By the way, this is 1996. Now, University of Medina has 15,000 students. So it's very different university than what it was. So you asked about my daily schedule.
The daily schedule, yes.
The daily schedule. Well, firstly, I have to say, I confess that I could not last in the dorms for more than a week.
1 week?
Less than a week.
Sheikh, some of us,
less than a week.
They say look, 6 months, right?
This was 1995, okay? Things were different back then. And Noisy. Also, the room they assigned me, the door had been left open for the whole summer. You know, the door of the balcony. I walk in and there's a layer of dust like this thick, the whole place, you know? I'm like, what is this? I can't. And of course, back then, things have changed now. Right now, they're like in 5-star compared to back then. The size of this desk, double it, and that was your space. Every student had like a bed and a small desk, and that's it. Like little, and then between one student and the other was a little cloth sheet. So you have a large room, and divided into cloth sheets, small little spaces. Allah. And I'm like, you know, I mean, alhamdulillah, I'm coming from a middle class family. I'm like, I can't live like this, you know. So I had savings from my engineering and whatnot. I had savings. So within a week, I found a place, apartment to live. And I was single. I wasn't even married at the time. So I moved out, and I for the rest of my 10 years, I lived in the various apartments over there. My daily schedule, so remember, I went through firstly the Arabic program, that was 1 year, and then the College of Hadith, that was 4 years. So for 5 years, my schedule was from 7:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Full-time classes. We took the equivalent back then of 25 credit hours. It was a very, very intensive, rigorous. I mean, they've changed it now. It's not that intensive anymore. After I left, they really cut back and watered down. Things have changed, obviously, from my perspective, for the worse. I caught the batch that was like the old school, where all the classes were simultaneous. If you failed one subject, you had to repeat the entire year again. If you failed one course, you had to take the whole year again. All over again. So we had 5 classes a day, 5 days a week. And so that's 25 credit hours. And we had on average 15 to 17 different teachers and subjects. And we had to have exams for all of them every single year, alhamdulillah. So went through all of that in my undergraduate. Alhamdulillah, I graduated with the imtiaz, which is like the top, you know, highest 90%. And then applied to the master's program. Alhamdulillah, got accepted to the master's program in the year 2000. And of course, in the master's program, the schedule changes. You have 1 year of coursework and then 3 years of dissertation. Mm-hmm. And alhamdulillah, I got the top of my class in the master's program. Alhamdulillah, bifadlillah ta'ala. And then my dissertation was highest rank as well, imtiaz ma'asharaf al-ula. And then I made the choice that I don't want to finish my PhD and I wanted to come back. 9/11 had happened, many things had happened. And for many reasons, I don't want to be too explicit, but I began to realize that I needed to be exposed to different knowledge as well. That alhamdulillah, I was very happy with Medina, but my own curiosity and my own, I was getting like blocks intellectually. I needed to be exposed to other knowledges as well. And I was very happy with my 10 years in Medina, 1995 to 2005. And so again, my teachers were all shocked, like, because they were expecting me as a shoo-in. You're going to be the first American with a PhD. That would have been the case if I had continued. It wasn't something that I wanted to do at that stage. And I then, alhamdulillah, came back and finished my PhD from here.
So Shaykhna, and I remember the first time I saw your name, it wasn't in America, believe it or not. I started to practice when I went to visit Palestine. I went into a maktaba for one of the shabab in the masjid, mashallah. All of the shabab donated. They had a huge maktaba in one of the masjids close to the Quds. And I took this big book out, and I'm like, it says Yasir, Sheikh, or Ustad Yasir Qadi, or Sheikh Yasir Qadi. I'm like, who's Yasir? I'm like, do you guys know Yasir Qadi? It says bin al-Waliyat al-Muttahida, and they're like, I think it was your master's dissertation. What was the topic, Sheikh?
My master's dissertation was entitled The Theology of Jahm ibn Safwan, one of the early people of this ummah. He died 124 Hijrah, and his effects on Islamic movement.
That's so what it was.
A very early figure who was a very controversial figure in early Islam. He had views that were considered to be heterodox, and nobody had studied him. Alhamdulillah, so I wrote a 850-page dissertation in Arabic.
Yeah, I remember it was thick. MashaAllah,
yes, it's still around two volumes in Arabic.
Alhamdulillah. Allah mizan hasanatik, Shaykh. It's all in your skills, inshallah ta'ala. So that leads me to the next question. So you stayed in Medina for about 8 years?
Ten.
10 years.
1995 to 2005.
So you must have studied with many scholars, because I know Medina is like a stop for many ulama from around the world. Everybody comes, they stop, they stay in Medina, they visit the masjid of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you must have seen many ulama, but which ones can you say you benefited from most, or that were highlights in your past?
So alhamdulillah, being in Medina for 10 solid years and going through the programs at the University of Medina, and the old school program, like I said, we had on average 15 to 17 different instructors per year. And then the master's program. So I studied with over 150 ulama and mashayikh, alhamdulillah, in my 10 years there. We actually, our graduating class, we have a whole list of the teachers in the undergraduate, and then of course added to that is my master's level, and then of course added to that, so the serious student of knowledge doesn't just restrict himself to what the university does. The serious student of knowledge also goes and finds teachers outside in the haram and one-on-one in their houses. And alhamdulillah, Allah blessed me to study with many of those as well. I mean, the very first day that I came to Medina, literally the first day I was in the haram, literally. I had my pant and shirt on. I didn't even have a thobe. I made dua to Allah that, oh Allah, help me find a sheikh for Quran that will benefit me. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know there were lots of mashayikh there. And I was like, oh Allah, allow me to, you know, get to somebody that will benefit me. And I just saw one sheikh there with a small halaqa. And I introduced myself and I said, Shaykh, I want to get ijazah from you. I'm hafiz, and I want to get ijazah in Hafs and Shu'bah and Asim, back to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the Shaykh was very like kid in a pant and shirt, and where are you from? America. So he calmed down, okay, America, okay. But he goes, next time don't come to me in a pant and shirt, come to me in a thobe. I feel very embarrassed. Yeah. Like I literally went out the same evening and got a thobe, 10 riyal thobe. I didn't have cash on me at the time, so I got a 10 riyal thobe. 10 riyal, made in China back then. And then wore that the next day. And so that turned out to be my first Quran teacher, Sheikh Bashir Ahmed.
MashaAllah, well Sheikh Bashir in the haram.
He's my Sheikh, my ijazah is from Sheikh Bashir. He knows
really?
Me very well.
Old school. Now he's much bigger than what he was back then, I'm sure.
SubhanAllah. I made dua to Allah that Allah, let me find the one that will really, and so, alhamdulillah, he really shaped my tajweed and my qira'ah with wisdom. Finished ijazah with him in Hafs and Shu'bah. And then I studied with other mashayikh as well. Alhamdulillah, in 1995, Sheikh Mukhtar al-Shinqiti was not yet as famous as he was about to become. He was giving durus in the masjid of the Jami'a, the University of the Jami'a masjid. So I would attend with him. And the same year he got transferred to the haram in Medina, Sheikh Mukhtar al-Shinqiti, famous sheikh. And so I attended his first halaqa in the haram after having attended his halaqat in the university's masjid. And I stayed 10 years with Sheikh Shankliti. 10 years, alhamdulillah, never skipping if I was in town. If I'm traveling, then I'm traveling.
Sheikh Muhammad Mukhtar.
Muhammad Mukhtar, the one and only. Muhammad Mukhtar Shankliti. Study with him. I studied with Sheikh Abdul Razak Al-Abbad, who had a deep impact on me in Aqidah. He really had an impact on me. In Hadith, Sheikh Abdul Aziz Abdul Latif, he passed away with cancer. Allah arhamu. I was his last batch that he taught before he fell sick with cancer. is legend in hadith. Everybody knows his books and whatnot. Sheikh Muhammad Matar Zahrani, another sheikh who passed away after I graduated, but he wrote the books for the undergraduate curriculum. And he was already retired by the time I got to Medina. But alhamdulillah, some people introduced me to him, and I had a private lesson with him at home. Just me and one other brother, we'd drive to his house and study with him. Muntaqab ibn Jawrud, which is a very advanced book of hadith. It's not one of the famous six ones. We studied with that with him. I studied with the Sheikh Atiyah Salim before he passed away as well. I was to go to his house. He was the main student of the Shanqiti of the 60s and 70s. I studied with in the summer of 2000. I did not come back to America that year, and I traveled to Unayza, which is a small, hot Bedouin village in Najd, yes, to study with the legend, somebody who really, subhanAllah, had a profound impact on me on a personal level, and that is Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. And I sat with him for an entire summer. And by the end of the summer, he wrote me a tazkir, a letter of recommendation that I used to get into the master's program as well at Medina. And I still have that letter that he wrote, alhamdulillah. So I studied with a lot of scholars. Sheikh Muhammad al-Khalifa Tamimi in Aqidah, he was my advisor for the master's. And he went on to found the International Islamic University of Malaysia. He went and founded that after I studied with him. So when he was in Medina, he was the dean of the college. And then I came back to America, he went to Malaysia and founded a university over there, alhamdulillah. Mashallah. Alhamdulillah, I have studied with a lot of people, and from all of them I benefited from their ilm or from their adab, or even from like how not to teach. Sometimes I got teachers that weren't good teachers. So you learn from them how not to teach properly.
What not to
and I remember one of my teachers said this in class, that, you know, never ever underestimate or trivialize anybody whom you study with, because whoever you study with has something to teach you. Even if it's how everyone. Not to teach you. I remember he said that. And so I'm like, okay, subhanAllah. So,
alhamdulillah. You met a lot of mashayikh, Shaykh, and this is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the intercession of our shayukh and our ulama and these salihin that we met.
Ameen.
In
Ameen.
Our lives. Yani, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed you with, and all these mashayikh, rahmatullah alayhum, the ones who passed away. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve the ones who are still alive.
Ameen. Ameen.
But for the average Muslim now, we hear a lot of titles like Shaykh, Qari, Mufti, Alim. We have Alim courses, like people make them feel like they're going to be Alim once they finish it. What is the difference between all of these things? Like, just for the average Muslim, and Shaykh, if you don't mind, just a blunt question. Do you consider yourself a scholar or not?
SubhanAllah. Let me answer this first one first. These various titles, realize that our religion of Islam is not like the Catholic Church that has specific hierarchies that are bestowed by another power. So if you're like a Catholic, if you're a part of an organized hierarchical faith tradition, there is a body that assigns you a daraja, right? Mm-hmm. So you are a cardinal, you're a bishop, you're the pope. There's a particular hierarchy. Alhamdulillah, in Sunni Islam, we don't have that hierarchy at all. Now, that's positive, but then there comes a bit of a flip side, and that is that it does become a little bit of a free-for-all, which we all, we struggle with sometimes when we log onto the internet and we find people saying this, saying that. Well, I don't know the qualification. This guy's Mufti so-and-so, and Hafiz so-and-so, and Sheikh so-and-so, and Faqih so-and-so, and it does become difficult. So let me just state that all of these titles are honorary titles that people choose to give or choose to adopt. They really mean nothing in the end of the day. If a person chooses not to call himself whatever, it doesn't mean that they have or don't have knowledge. And the main way that we can recognize a person of knowledge is by the testimony of his peers. So when other groups of people whom we know to have knowledge acknowledge, oh, this person is, yes, a person of knowledge. This is the most important issue. Once upon a time, it used to be through what is called the ijazat system, or the notion of people, teachers, handing a license to teach, or a connection with you to the classical. But even that is now not what it used to be. Really, these titles don't mean much per se, and especially degrees title. Like these days, you can do a course, a mufti course, or a sheikh, or an alim course, or whatever. And Yani, there are many graduates from these universities who really are very weak in their knowledge, and there are those who have never stepped foot in the universities and they're very strong in their knowledge. So I would take all of these titles with a grain of salt. What is more important is the quality of the content that people produce, what is called peer-reviewed. And of course, if you are not a part of that peer review, then look at others who are testifying to the peer review. Mm-hmm. As for your second question, that's a very difficult question, a very blunt question. I appreciate you asking it. The famous Alim al-Sha'bi died 105 Hijrah. Somebody called out to him, Ya Alim! O Alim! And al-Sha'bi said to him, the Alim is the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, that the only portion of Allah's creation who truly fears Him are the ulama. So you ask me that, do you consider yourself like a scholar or an alim? If you mean by that the Quranic definition, then subhanAllah, who amongst us can ever claim that? And definitely that's not something that I claim, and anybody who claims this, it is a problem. And this is not a false modesty, it is a reality that all of us are sinners, and I know my sins, and I thank Allah for having hidden them from all of you. So alhamdulillah, Allah knows my sins, and there is no way that in that sense anybody can call himself an alim. If you mean by scholar somebody of the caliber of Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, or even bigger than this, Imam An-Nawawi, ibn Taymiyyah, ibn Hajar, I mean, of course not. These were polymaths. These were experts in all the fields. And all of us will remain minor students of knowledge until we die. We're always going to be looking up to these giants and referencing them. At the same time, that is then the awkward question of where exactly does that place somebody like me? And I mean, any person who studies ilm, and I have been studying nonstop for 25 years, even after 10 years of Medina, I mean, I'm studying every single day. It is my full-time occupation. No day goes by, even when I'm on vacation, quote unquote. There is no vacation from ilm, and you're always reading and doing something. So it's been 25 years of my life that I have full time, and more than this, part time. So clearly you can't just be like nobody, you have to have something. So generally speaking, a person who dedicates his life to Islam, they are aware of all of the fields of Islam to a basic level. And they understand the sciences of Islam, they know the references of Islam, they can look up almost any issue because they know the encyclopedias. To that level, alhamdulillah, I'm very comfortable. But in my particular case, I've also gone and studied beyond the basics in certain areas. And in one or two areas in particular, alhamdulillah, I'm very comfortable debating with and discussing issues at the most advanced level. For example, theology, and especially early theology. My master's and my PhD was on Aqidah, Islamic theology, and especially when it comes to the development of the various schools of Islamic theology, whether it's Sunnism or the other schools as well. Alhamdulillah, I mean, this is anybody who is an expert, a world-class expert, me and him can have a very good conversation at a very good level, alhamdulillah, because this is my expertise. It is the area that I published academic papers in, and I have my master's. You can go and read it, and alhamdulillah, that's no issues there. Along with this, alhamdulillah, there are other areas that I have, because of my own passion, really done a lot of research on. Seerah is one example where I've read pretty much all of the major books of Seerah, and I have a good understanding, and we can have very good discussions with anybody who's a specialist in Seerah. As well, in certain aspects of Ulum al-Quran, I thank Allah, I've always had a passion for various aspects of Ulum al-Quran, and the sciences of the Quran as well. There are certain areas that I think I was talking with you or others, that I've even had very good discussions with some of the world experts on specific issues, and I have my understandings, and I've presented it to them, and we've gone back and forth. So alhamdulillah. In other areas, I feel comfortable being a good student of knowledge, comfortable enough to hold my own opinions as long as others have said them. I don't do independent ijtihad. For example, most of the fiqh of ibadat, the fiqh of tahara, salah, whatnot, alhamdulillah, I'm very comfortable teaching and preaching and holding my views, but I don't ever hold a view that is unique, because I'm not at that level. There must be somebody before me that said it, or some counsel at least. I never break away and become independent. This is fiqh al-ibadat and tahara and eating and drinking and other stuff of this nature, fiqh of dress and whatnot, alhamdulillah. There are areas that I do consider myself a minor student of knowledge, and I don't even have independent ijtihad following others. I really kind of make blind taqleed. For example, Islamic economics. I always say, modern Islamic economics is not my forte. I have spent years studying theology and seerah and aspects of tafsir and Quran. I've never had a passion for economics. You know, people have different passions. I think the average person doesn't understand the Islamic sciences are just as varied as, let's say, biology, right? You can have a PhD in biology and be very ignorant about one area of biology, but you have a good knowledge of one area of speciality. You couldn't get a PhD without specializing in one aspect, but it's very possible that another discipline of biology and you have a very, very vague knowledge of it. The same goes for Islamic sciences. It's a vast field and nobody can master all of the sciences of Islam. There are areas that I do feel I am very well grounded into the point of independent research. There are areas that I feel very comfortable. And then there are areas where I say, you know what, let me go to the others. And amongst them is Islamic economics. I don't ever give independent fatwas about Islamic economics.
So Sheikh, right now what we did was like sort of redefine the word scholar, right? Because is there anyone in the world that is really a scholar in all of the sciences of Islam?
If you ask me, I have never met anybody like that. Never.
Never.
Never. These are people that might have existed in the past, but there's simply too much knowledge out there to master every single discipline. It's simply, now there are those who have mastered more than one, mashallah. For example, the Arabic language and fiqh, mashallah, they're great. But to say that you're a master of sciences of hadith and the qiraat and tafsir and history and I have never met anybody like this, and I don't think it is even possible, because the other thing that you realize is that, you know, a scholar who existed 1,000 years ago, actually the sciences are a little bit more limited and the books are limited. If you're coming now at the end of all of this, you're at the tail end of 14 centuries, right, of history. So you have to know in a good amount of detail pretty much all of the major books written in every single discipline for the last 14 centuries in order for you to then contribute something new. So to claim that a person is a master of all of the Islamic disciplines, I mean, I have never met anybody like this, and I don't think anybody like this could possibly exist. And I'll give you one simple reality check. No matter how much a sheikh might know of fiqh or of hadith or of tafsir, ask them about Islamic history. Islamic history is a very needed topic, and it really broadens your horizons. Hardly anybody's mastered history and also, you know, advanced fiqh and whatnot. Ask the scholar of qira'at about the taqrij of hadith. So these are all different specialities. And alhamdulillah, we thank Allah that people of specialities can master their specialities. This also means the average Muslim should be aware of these broad specialities so that you don't ask the wrong person, right, to the question that needs to be asked. Don't go to the qira'at expert and ask the qira'at expert about some advanced issue of hadith unless they've studied it, and vice versa.
Okay, so it's not some generic title like, this is a scholar, therefore I can ask him about anything.
This is one of the biggest mistakes that the average Muslim makes, that they think that a person who studied for 4 years can answer any question about the Islamic sciences. And the Islamic sciences are more vast than all of engineering or all of biology. They're more varied than any. It's like literally saying the humanities. They are so varied. The Arabic language itself is one discipline.
Right, so.
And Arabic literature. And you can go on and on and on. And the beginning student of knowledge literally scratches the surface of maybe the main 14, 15 fields, and that's it. Just scratches the surface to have an idea of the basics of these. Then some people specialize. Most people after an average undergraduate degree don't even specialize, and they just, it's like saying you have a bachelor's in biology, okay? Okay, you're able to teach biology at middle school, high school, but you cannot contribute something new until you study 20, 30 years of biology. You get my point here, that there are different levels of even scholarship and knowledge, and we need to put everybody in his place and also in his speciality.
So Sheikh, just out of curiosity, there's a personal question as well. What science do you like more? Do you like fiqh or usul fiqh?
So when it comes to usul al-fiqh, I put my level as that of a intermediate student, not at the advanced level. I have not studied usul al-fiqh comparatively as much as I would like to. It's always been one of those areas that I would want to study more. So definitely at this stage, the fields that attract me the most, that I'm most interested in actually, believe it or not, are, and it's always been for the last 25 years, the main field is, no, not theology, it is Ulum al-Qur'an. For me, it's always been the most fascinating field, the sciences of the Qur'an, and alhamdulillah, I'm still very active, but I don't publicize or I don't write books about this anymore, but alhamdulillah, I'm very active, and there are circles that are well aware of what we are doing in terms of issues pertaining to Ulum al-Qur'an. Alhamdulillah.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase you, Shaykhna. Allah barik feekum, ya Rabbi, yahfadkum. So now, we stayed a little too long on one of the questions, but I really want you to answer this one today, inshallah. After coming back to the States, 10 years in Medina, dealing with what you dealt with, seeing what you saw, obviously a different, completely different mindset and world. You come back to America, how did you readapt to America? Like, did you quarantine yourself for a bit?
Quarantine, don't use that word right now.
I know, we're quarantined right now.
So you need to, coming back to America was a conscious decision. It wasn't thrust upon me. I made the decision, like I said, that 9/11, you know, everybody says 9/11 was a changing game changer. For me, it really, really was. Like, I was in Medina when I saw the Twin Towers fall, and I was doing my master's at the time. And I saw the war on terror. I saw the name of my religion being, you know, stereotyped, hatred, Islamophobia. And I really began to feel that, hey, I need to come back and start being active. I can't just remain in this bubble, isolated. And like Medina was a quarantine, if anything. Like, I'm not coming and teaching my people. Mm. And I also began to realize, and this is awkward to say, I'm going to be generic, and وَالْلَبِيبُ بِالْإِشَارَةِ يَفْهَمُوا. I began to realize that I needed to broaden my horizons if I wanted to be truly effective in my own community. I couldn't just stay in a foreign land and a foreign culture and absorb even more of a particular strand of Islam, which had its pros, but it also had its cons. Mm. And if I really wanted to be effective amongst my own people, I needed to expose myself to the culture of my own peoples. My own peoples, I mean, وَإِلَىٰ عَدٍ أَخَاهُمْ وَذَوِلَىٰ ثَمُوَذَ أَخَاهُمْ. Like, these are my people over here. I was born and raised here. This is my land. I speak English, and I went through their systems, and this is my mother tongue. My mother's tongue is Urdu. My mother tongue is English, right? So I realized the need that I need to come back, and I need to expose myself to disciplines and to thought processes that hitherto I had quarantined myself away from, okay, if you want to use the word quarantine. And so in 2003, I began looking at the various PhD programs in the Western world. And I spent an entire summer going over every single program in the Western world, and I applied to a number of I was a bit, highfalutin. I only wanted to get into the best of the best, the creme de la creme. And so I applied to the best of the best. Alhamdulillah, I got accepted to Oxford in England and to Yale in America. I had to make a choice between the two, and prayed istikhara and for other factors, and I chose to come to Yale. It was a bit of a shock for all of my professors and teachers, because like I said, I would have been the first American to graduate with a PhD ever in the history of Medina. And it was just a shoe, and there was nobody. I was the first, the highest level American ever to get in and whatnot. And it would have been, but it was a big shock to them. But there were certain mashayikh that encouraged me, and I don't mind mentioning now, in hindsight, like Sheikh Safar al-Hawali was one of my biggest encouragements to go, and Sheikh Salman al-Awda, may Allah Azza wa Jal free them both. They're in jail right now. By the way, you asked me who I benefited from these two also. Yes. Even though I didn't study with them, but they both knew me on a personal basis. I would visit them in their houses while I was in Medina. And they're the ones who encouraged me more than anybody else. And also Sheikh Al-Dami, I had an interview with him, the Indian convert from Hinduism who became the dean of the College of Hadith. He also said to me, leave and go. He said to me that, don't study here, go.
When you were in Medina?
When I was in Medina. Like meaning after the masters, like go and do your PhD over there, you know.
And out of the mashayikh, subhanAllah, like Sheikh Safar al-Hawali and Sheikh Salman.
Sheikh Safar, what he said to me was the most encouraging. Like he said, almost like it's farad for you to leave. I was like, ya Sheikh, I'm in Medina. It's like, يعني كم كنا نجد طالب مثلك. I remember I was in his house, literally me and him like this, and he's like, he was telling me like this, like how we were waiting for a student like you to come from America, study with us, and then go back and study over there. I said, Sheikh, I'm going to do the PhD, and I might have to hear things that I can't respond to. I'm going to, and he goes, look, your niyya is to learn so that you can defend Islam. Allah knows your niyya. You're learning things that you might not have answers to so that you can defend Islam. Mm. And that stayed with me, and it still stays with me, and it's been, how long has it been, Yani? Allahumma. Almost 18, 17 years ago he said that, 16 years ago he said that to me, and that still is in my mind. That, you know, so alhamdulillah, I went knowing that I'm walking into a lion's den like nobody, and again, I'm not trying to, but people know this, that no. Back in 2004, 2005, it was very rare for an observant practicing Muslim to be in a PhD in Islamic studies. That too was rare. It was unheard of for a madrasa graduate to be doing a PhD at an Ivy League. I'm like one of the first. There was one person before me back in the 60s, 70s, Dr. Muzammil. Those were different times. He did his PhD from Harvard. But since then up until now, no Medina student has ever gone to an American PhD in Islamic study. Even to this day, nobody has. It's just not done. You don't even get in. It was a miracle from Allah that I got in. I had very high GRE scores and you know everything, alhamdulillah. I mean, alhamdulillah, Allah blessed me to have that. But generally speaking, even that's not done. So I knew I was walking in. Not only that, I wanted Islamic studies, which is the most difficult because their version of Islamic studies is totally different than our version, like literally night and day. And everybody knows this, I've said this in other lectures as well, even though it's been misunderstood. But I'd be very honest here that I walked in thinking, huh, what can they teach me that I don't already know? I know this religion better than any of these guys do. And they didn't teach me the religion better than I knew because I knew better than them. But the thing is, they knew I knew better than them. They knew it. Every one of them knew that I knew better. They would ask me questions about fiqh and tafsir and whatever. But what they knew was things I did not know. And it's beyond the scope of our interview here to go into detail about this, but it's really the methodology of research and the methodology of taking a broader picture and contextualizing and looking at facts from different angles and critical thinking and source critical engagement, which is stuff that we really don't do in the Eastern tradition. And the you know, we're just taught to hear and obey. And there are questions you have and you're like, don't ask those, don't go there. And of course in the West, no holds barred, question everything. And so it was a very interesting phase where the way that I portray it is as follows. Imagine somebody hands you a big building and says, this is what your ancestors gave to you. And you think it is a solid constructed building. Going into the Western system, you realize it's a bunch of Lego blocks that people have put together. And they open it apart and they show you, hey, no, this is not one building, it's Lego blocks. It's not a structure that's solid. It's clearly pieced together. And that's really what you begin to see, that a lot of what I consider to be just a building is really not a building. It is layered by layer developed over time. And so you really start thinking in a different manner. Allah. And that's advanced, you know, no need for this. But the point is that it makes you a deeper thinker, makes you a critical thinker. It makes you as well more broad-minded and more tolerant, less fanatical and less yani, narrow-minded, because you realize the human element of the tradition. And alhamdulillah, I mean, I think you see the product. I mean, you know,
before and after.
Before and after. And then I know a lot of people miss the old YQ, but okay, alhamdulillah. I mean, I have I do not regret any phase that I've been in my life. I thank Allah for broadening my horizons. I am who I am because of everything that Allah blessed me and my parents. Going through 10 years of Medina and then 8 years of Yale, that combination, and then active da'wah at the national, international, global scale, experience, teaching and mixing with people, going through my University of Rhodes College, I was a professor for 9 years over there, teaching hundreds of undergraduate students over there at a private university. All of these things, it shapes you. It causes you to realize, to think. One of my teachers said to me, you're never going to master what you know until you teach it to others. And I found this to be so true. Teaching and teaching and teaching forces you to rethink, forces you to restructure, and it makes you far more better in understanding what you thought you had simplistically memorized. And that's why nonstop I just teach, 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 and alhamdulillah, I forever plan to remain a student of knowledge, studying more and more till the day that I die, inshallah ta'ala.
Allahu barak fik, Shaykhna. Yani, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve you and increase from your likes in the ummah. We really need scholarship in the ummah, and we really need your guidance and your advice.
I mean, but again, I'd like to point out, and Murad, this is not, wallahi, it's not a type of self-humility. Be careful of taking a living person and putting him in a high pedestal. Don't base your iman on living people. If you really must, base it on those that have gone away. Ibn Taymiyyah, or Ibn Hajar, or An-Nawawi, or Al-Ghazali. Look at those and aggrandize them as much as you want. Never link your iman to a living personality, because I am human, you're human, all of us are human, and I don't want a slip that I might make to be a slip for Islam, a'udhu billah. May Allah protect me and you, but we have to be careful, because we've seen this already happen in the past. And again, I have to be very, this isn't false humility or modesty. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to cover my sins and your sins, but I'm a human being, right, in the end of the day. And you don't know me, and I don't know you. And it is all too common to put somebody on a very, very high pedestal. It's a slippery slope. You put somebody higher and higher. Mm. When that person slips a little bit, a human slip, because you have made him also almost into an angel, right? That human slip for you is like, oh my God, all of our ulama like that. No, be careful. So with all these adjectives, mm-hmm. Murad, just yani, bismillah, ask Allah to protect me and you, preserve me and you, guide me and you, and guide others through me and you. That's really the main point, inshallah.
And forgive me, Shaykh, I didn't mean to like approach you that way, but yani, we love you. And we want you to stay around us. We're happy for you to be here. I'm happy for myself to be here in Epic Masjid, which leads me to the last question. Inshallah, forgive me. I just want to apologize to the audience. We started about 10 minutes after we were supposed to, so we're going to extend it about 15 minutes. You know, 10 to make up and 5 rida.
Alhamdulillah.
The halal, right?
Alhamdulillah.
Sheikh Yasser, it can't be halal.
Alhamdulillah.
But Sheikh, so now you've been to many masajid all over the world, in the United States, outside the United States, and out of all the masajid and all the communities you could have went to, you came to Epic Masjid, East Plano Islamic Center in Plano, Texas. What was it that you saw in this masjid that kind of like, you know, took you, made you say, hey, I want to be part of this community. This is where I'm at, right here. Like, I just want you to elaborate on your thoughts and your feelings, what you felt when you first came.
You're really putting me in the hot seat here, Murad. You're like all glares right here, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. So, a time came in my previous city that I just felt I needed to move to a larger city. I was very happy where I was, but I felt that I had reached a plateau and I needed to now move to a larger city and give back to a different community. Also for my parents' sake, I needed, they were elderly and they couldn't live on their own, so they wanted to move to, you know, with me, and we needed a larger city. So I did look at a number of places, and alhamdulillah, I have many opportunities, different places, but I decided I want to come back to Texas, which is my home state in the end of the day. It's where I was born and raised. I have, you know, even though Houston is my city, but still Houston, Dallas, for me, they're very similar, alhamdulillah.
You're
Texas. Texas, major city of Texas, alhamdulillah. And I was looking at the masajid in this area, and alhamdulillah, there were a number of communities that were interested. For me, the main thing about East Plano really was the potential to take this community and make it a role model community. I really felt that, inshallah, it's a win-win for all of us. Like, I'm looking for a community that I can benefit and can benefit me. Mm-hmm. And I felt that, alhamdulillah, East Plano as well is able to have somebody like me, a place for me. Because I don't want to step on other people's toes. I want to go to a place where there's going to be, because one thing everybody knows about me, inshallah, even though online people don't probably realize this, but in person, I don't ever cause any fitna. I know online people love refuting me and they have these video clips and Facebooks and Twitter, but inshallah, I'm the type of person, avoid controversy and really just let people say what they want. I don't want to cause any issues. So the community has to be, alhamdulillah, one that wants someone like me and it's not going to cause any issues. And I felt Epic is just that type of community that I can benefit and be who I am, and they can, you know, benefit me. I can benefit them. They'll have a space for me, and they'll also have a space for me to grow and do what I'm doing. So I need a community to base myself in, as I do other projects as well. I'm with the Islamic Seminary, I'm with other places. And for me, this community of EPIC offered multiple things. First and foremost, and I have to say this really, really moved me a lot, to see their Fajr and Isha Salah. Like hardly any community in North America has, I mean, I want to almost cry now because it's empty, but yes, 400 or 500 people would come, and now it is dead empty because of the coronavirus. But Allah musta'an. But to see 400 or 500 people come for Fajr, you know, it's just something so peaceful and nice. Like, you want a community like this, you know? To see the facilities of East Plano, I have never seen in my all travels of America the types of facilities that East Plano has built, EPIC has built for its youth. The basketball court is state-of-the-art basketball court. Like, even gyms would be jealous when they look at what EPIC has. And this is a Muslim-owned, alhamdulillah. And to see that this is the vision of the community, because for me, it's all about preserving Islam in the next generation and the generations after that. For me, I'm looking forward, not backward. For me, I'm concerned about the youth and the youth after them, my children and their and my grandchildren. That's my audience. It's not, mashallah, the uncles and aunties that have already preserved Islam, they're coming. Them, alhamdulillah, their iman is strong. I need to look at the future. And I saw that EPIC is also looking at the future, that they're looking at what's going to happen in the next generation. The investment is in our children and grandchildren. Those are the people we need to take care of. Because in the end of the day, if we don't preserve Islam for them, how is it going to flourish? No. So looking at that attitude and recognizing that this community understood the main investment is the next generation. And I told them, look, you know, my views and my khutbahs and my styles is going to be a little bit more modern. Some of the uncles are going to complain, no topi, English khutbah, this and that, you know, and that's exactly what happened. But alhamdulillah, they're all good, they all love. But my concern is not the elders that come all the time. My concern is the youngsters that hardly come. That's my concern. I want to get them to come. I want them to be enthused. So I told the board, and alhamdulillah, the board's on the exact same wavelength, that look, we need to preserve for the next generation. And we understand that, okay, you might have some ideas and ways, whatnot, but alhamdulillah, we trust you. Alhamdulillah, they have trusted me and stood by me through all that has happened in the last few months, alhamdulillah. And alhamdulillah, the community has accepted me with welcoming arms, and it was indeed the right choice that was made on both sides. Alhamdulillah, I'm very, very, very thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I have a community like EPIC where I can feel useful and I can benefit from them, because I need a large group that of diverse people, of diverse backgrounds. That's how a person like me benefits. Difficult questions, poking and prodding, like you, Murad, you come and you ask these really difficult questions, right? And I thank you for doing that, because I need those types of questions. I have a bunch of youth that come and they ask a whole different series of questions. I have, you know, the uncles that come, they ask. That's exactly what I need, to be on that hot spot, surrounded by a community of diverse backgrounds. And alhamdulillah, that causes me to be on my toes, and that gains in the experience and wisdom. So I thank Allah Azza wa Jal for this community and for East Plano Masjid. And I genuinely believe, and I hope that this is shown to all of you as well, I genuinely believe we have the potential to be a positive influence, not just in Plano, not just in Dallas, but across North America, frankly, across the English-speaking globe. We have that potential. Together with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can and we will become a role model community. We're going to show people what it means to be a faithful, committed Muslim in the modern world. That's what we want. We don't want to compromise on our values, but at the same time, we want to move forward. We want to preserve this deen. That requires a fine balance. Where do we fine tune? Where do we stick to our grounds? Where do we stick to our guns? What is so? That's where this conversation is taking place. And alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, EPIC has been ideal. And I hope that inshallah, this is just the future, just the beginning of a much, much brighter future. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifts this coronavirus thing from us so that we can resume our in-person. I really miss the hustle and bustle of the community. I miss, you know, the hundreds of people that come, the thousands that come. I was looking forward to the Taraweeh that I heard was, I'm so sad I'm not going to see my first Taraweeh over here, looks like, but I was looking forward to the packed Taraweeh. And now, Qaddar Allah. But still, the potential is here, the facilities are here, and the da'wah is going on. Even this shows the potential of EPIC. Look, subhanAllah, as soon as this crisis hit, you guys set up the green room. This is a green room, guys. I keep on telling you, I'm not in the masjid. They set up a green room, they got professional cameras, they got the lighting here, and now we are broadcasting from EPIC. That is what I'm talking about, the mindset, which alhamdulillah really needs to be here. So I thank Allah Azza wa Jal for this. It's a win-win. I mean, I need a group like this, and I hope you guys also see some benefit in having me. Alhamdulillah, that's exactly what is needed. We ask Allah for qabool and for ikhlas. Alhamdulillah.
Sheikh, jazakumullah khair for everything you shared today. Fan, we are really, really grateful to have you here in the community. I came after you. But inshallah ta'ala, Sheikhna, we just want everyone to know what we are doing here in EPIC. EPIC Masjid is exactly the way Sheikh Yasser described it. It wants to be that leading masjid in everything, inshallah, for all of the English-speaking countries and for all of the English-speaking communities around the world. It has the potential. We are doing a lot. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, the way we reacted to this pandemic, as soon as it began, we went into like full throttle. And we have a program, about 8 different programs a day, alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, for every different age group in the community. And we are still exploring new options. We're trying to do new things. We're trying to add new things. Alhamdulillah, we're adapting to this situation. So for however long it's going to take, alhamdulillah, EPIC is prepared, but it needs your help and your support, inshallah. Without your help and support, we can't continue to do any of this, because at the end of the day, we are a masjid, and you, the believers, are the ones who keep these masajid going. So please do not forget us in your donations. The link is right here under the video. Please, inshallah, with anything. And if it's something that can be continuous, it's even better. Jazakumullah khair. If there's any masjid you want to help, it's this masjid that is leading the rest of the masajid, inshallah, into the future of our ummah, that is focused on the youth, that is focused on Islamic scholarship, that is delivering all of this content to their community and to the Muslim communities all over the world. Jazakumullah khair.
لا يزال الخير حيا لا يزال إن في الدنيا سلاما وظلال أخبر الأيام أنها في وصال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال